How are we doing, class? This is lecture on academic integrity and ethics. I'm Paul Strykowski. We have met before. As you recall, I'm your associate dean and a professor of mechanical engineering, and I'm gonna go through some issues today that I think are really important in your lives and certainly are important in your academic life in the years ahead. So this is pretty simple in a sense. The Board of Regents has a policy. You may not know it, but all of your syllabi are linked to this policy. It's section 4, subsection 1, and it's wonderful reading. Let's take a look. Basically, it tells you what scholastic dishonesty is at the University of Minnesota. The document actually goes on for many, many pages, but you take a look at this. If you read it a little bit, you'll notice it talks about plagiarism, cheating on assignments, falsification of information. It goes on and on, but really, we can end the lecture here by saying simply, don't cheat. It's that simple. Well, it may be that simple, but I think there's more to understanding what drives us as individuals and how cheating is just a part of a systemic issue we have as people. So backing up, you know, if you do some research on it, and you can think about this yourself as well, why do people cheat? There are some realistic reasons. One thing we can admit, we are now in week 11, I believe, of the semester. I think you would all agree that there's been some stress in your lives. There's no question about it. First semester in college is a difficult one. A lot of transitions. And so stress is certainly a driver. So what kind of stress? Well, stress associated with the desire to succeed. We want to do well. We want to do well for a variety of reasons. Certainly, we have pressure from our parents. We have pressure from ourselves, expectations of ourselves. There are pressure from our parents. And there are certainly pressures from financial side of thing. Many, many years ago when I went to college, I knew, well, it wasn't that expensive. If I made a mistake or something, I could retake a class. Now the stakes are much higher, and we understand that. So there's some pressure on you for that kind of issue. Sometimes your professors are just unreasonable in your eyes. They've asked you to do things. You know, I might ask you to do 4 things. The other instructor might ask you to do 3 or 4 things. Next thing you know, you've got a plate, and it's just not possible for you to get it done. Or you might feel that what I've written as an exam is unfair, or the assignments are unfair, or perhaps my grading system is unreasonable. And so you might use that in a way to justify an action, which would speak to this question of cheating. Not defending or justifying cheating, it's just being knowledgeable of the things as humans that drive us to make these decisions, I think is quite important. Peer pressure. What do you mean by peer pressure? Certainly, you might be in a scenario where some one of your lab mates, classmates, you're working together on an assignment. You know, you get to be good friends, and they pressure you. They say, well, man, come on, give that to me. I really could use that. I'm really pressed this week. I have an extra couple exams. Not that big a deal. And so that can drive your decision-making as well. And justifying it that everyone does it, or you see other people do it. I don't think this is super common, but it is true that it sometimes can be pervasive. Perhaps more in high school than in college, though it's important to note that cheating is addictive. And that is that the studies that have done on this, and there's been quite a bit of work on it, that something like 64% of students who cheat in high school, and again, we'll define that. It's really an important word to define. Those who cheat in high school will also cheat in college. And cheating actually leads more systemically to other issues continuously in life. And one thing I'd like you to think about a lot is, these decisions are often thought of, I want a good grade, but they really should be thought of more in terms of how it impacts my life. How will employers view this? How will a graduate program or medical school view these decisions that I make? I want to parse these words a bit. The lecture title is Academic Integrity and Ethics. So we could just say, don't cheat, lecture over, done deal. I'd rather take the view to look at the ethical side first, which is a larger conversation, which guides and governs our behavior and choices in life, and it's a balancing act. Once we sort of get our hands around that, our heads around what that means, then we sort of go back to how does this affect our decision-making in the academic world and ultimately in our professional worlds, in our social worlds, in the world that we want to live a good quality life. So we're good with graphs. I suspect this crowd is really good with graphs. So on the y-axis, I place ethical and unethical. So ethical behavior goes north, unethical south. And legal and illegal. So let's take a look at the quadrants. So I start with this graph, and we're gonna look in the upper right quadrant, the positive, if you like. These are situations where you are acting legally and you are acting ethically. We would call this the good life. Now, on the other hand, if you do illegal things, which are unethical, you're probably going to spend a lot of time in places you don't want to talk about. All right? Not a good place to be. So these two quadrants are sort of self-evident. Not a lot we need to discuss. However, let's talk about the other two. Scenarios which are illegal, but you view to be ethical or correct choices to make, and situations which are legal, but are indeed, you believe, unethical. At the outset, we understand that there is gray area here, and these are not easy things. They're easy things to think about internally, think about how you would answer them, not necessarily easy to discuss it publicly. So at this point, I'd like you to consider situations in life, not academically, but in life, or could be academically, which you consider to be illegal, but ethical. I came up with a couple on my own. You could say if you know someone in the neighborhood house is injured, you can see him through the window, you decide to break into the house. Breaking into a house is illegal, but you say, well, I have to do it. It's the right thing to do, so you do it. The classic example of a pregnant woman needing to get to the hospital, she's in labor. You could share medication with someone to save their life. However, sharing medication is illegal. It's against the law. And removing someone from life support. Now, certainly that is illegal in certain circumstances without certain documents that are prepared ahead of time, but you might view it's ethical. And of course, I put the question mark there, maybe not of course, but I put it there because we might not all agree on things that you agree with me that might be illegal or illegal, and legal is pretty clear, but what you view and I view as ethical. So take the other side. Something which is legal is allowed in our society, but unethical. First, consider this individually, as before, and then take a few minutes to talk about it in your groups. I came up with several. And again, the question mark is pretty critical here. Slavery certainly was legal in this country. We know that. It was legal all over many parts of the world. Eventually, it was abolished, really 1863. But even into the 60s, and some would argue today, segregation of African Americans, treatment of American Indians. Some would argue, well, certainly when we came to this land, but also even today. Issues like abortion, death penalty. Now, these issues are legal and some are not legal. Death penalty is not legal in all states. And you certainly are entitled to your opinions on their level of ethnic, whether they're ethical or not, pardon that. So these are some examples that I came up with. So now I just want to transpose the x-axis. Instead of going ethical, unethical, I want to consider cheating, not cheating. Thinking about cheating and not cheating in the sense of law. So this was actually a very comprehensive survey done of a great research paper, and I'll certainly give it to you if you'd like. It's rather long. Results from 600 plus science and engineering undergraduates from 11 institutions covering a full gamut. And they were asked these questions anonymously before they had a lecture on the subject. And they could answer each question as either cheating, unethical but not cheating, or neither. So let's just take a look. First one, copying from another student during a test or quiz. So maybe take a minute. I don't expect you to write this down. I don't expect you to talk to your neighbors. Just think about it, because I don't want you to feel like you're going to be judged by writing it down or you have to hide what you're writing. So just think about this for a second. Is copying from another student during a test or quiz cheating, unethical but not cheating, or neither? Perhaps no surprise, fortunately, 96% of students feel that's cheating. Fine, not much to talk about. Another one, copying an old lab report from a previous year. Cheating, unethical but not cheating, or neither? Again, take a moment to think about this. How would you answer it? Well, this survey concluded that 60% said it was cheating. Now 26% said it wasn't cheating, but it was unethical. And here, 12% felt it didn't fall into that category whatsoever. Why would that be? And finally, copying a passage out of a textbook for a homework assignment. In this case, probably without retribution. Cheating, unethical but not cheating, or neither. This one all of a sudden becomes very interesting. Only 19% said that was cheating. 36% unethical but not cheating. And the majority said it was neither. It was clearly something they could do. Why is that? Why was that decision made? Individuals clearly have different thresholds for making these decisions, and it's that threshold we want to talk about in some length today. So in the legal sense, you would say petty misdemeanor is not as serious as a felony. You would say cheating on homework maybe is not as serious as it on an exam. So at this point, I want to take a moment, break, and I want to take a look at a video. And after the video, we want to ask ourselves, why do we lie? Now I want you to spend a few minutes after looking. I actually love that video. We all lie. We lie a lot, actually, if you think about it. I want you to spend a few minutes individually writing down scenarios where you would consider lying. You don't have to share it. If you don't want to write it down for fear someone might see what you're thinking, just think about it. Why would you lie? Under what scenarios? I want to throw a scenario out here and ask you a question about it. You and your spouse agree to run on the treadmill every day, sort of an understanding you have, good for your health. 1 week, your spouse is traveling, you decide to take a week off from running. However, you're afraid that when your spouse comes home, they're going to say, hey, were you on the treadmill every day? So you say to yourself, what I'm going to do every day is I'm going to go down on the treadmill, stand on it for a second, and get off it, and go and buy my coffee. So the question is, when your spouse returns and he or she does ask, did you get on the treadmill every day? You answer, yes. It's true. Did you lie? The question there is, were you within the technical limits of some law, but perhaps without a shred of virtue? Did the person asking that question expect you to give an honest answer or not? Scenario two. Your instructor, someone like myself, tells you that you can't speak to one another in the next 24 hours during a take-home examination. You decide to speak to a student who took the class last semester. Did you cheat? The letter of the law would suggest that the instructor said you cannot speak to anyone else in class. He or she did not say anything about another class, didn't say anything about the web. Did you cheat? This is a saying that I like to keep close. A colleague of mine, Warren Eibel, professor many years ago, told me this, and I really love it. And Gerald Grant wrote it. For we can be within the technical limits of the law without a shred of virtue. Think about that once. What is legal? What is cheating or not cheating? Shouldn't come down to a word. Can I defend it? Can I argue it? It should come down to what is right? What feels right in my gut? So to end, as young adults, try to view these decisions that you make. And they're not, yes, they right now they have to do with academic issues. They're going to ultimately deal with workplace issues. Decisions you make about, is this thing that you build or design going to last? Is it ethical? Try to view it through an ethical lens more than trying to find loopholes in the rules. This is something you will continue to grapple with as you grow older. We all do. But I tell you, that then provides a threshold for you above which you are ethically doing the right thing. Hope you enjoy the lecture. All for now.